You had two choices this afternoon, a Red Sox game not too far from here, or the Campagna-Kerven lecture on modern Turkey. And given the performance of the Red Sox over the last week or so, I think you made the right choice. This is actually the 21st lecture in the series that began in 1995. And the distinguishing mark of the series, it seems to me, is that it has been wonderfully inclusive. We've had architects, public intellectuals, business people, journalists, political scientists, anthropologists, world famous novelist, cartoonist. And in fact, when the lecture began, and it began largely because of the founding inspiration of a woman I'm going to talk about in a moment, there was only one restriction posed, and that is the lecture would not be a forum for government officials. Feeling which government officials have plenty of forums already, so that once they retire, they're eligible. But basically, the idea is to bring in as many different voices on modern Turkey as possible, and to do it in a way that was both pleasing to scholars, but also accessible to students and the general public. For those of you interested in any of the past lectures, you can go to the website, bu.edu/CKLS, and you'll find streaming video of the most recent videos going back, most recent lectures going back about 8 years. So welcome. I'm going to take a few moments before we introduce our speaker to talk about Suzanne Campagna. Suzanne Campagna was born in Istanbul in 1917. Her father, Mehmet Nahit Kerven, who's honored in the lecture series title, was one of the original Young Turks, young follower of Mustafa Kemal Atatürk, and a close associate of İsmet İnönü, who of course succeeded Atatürk as the leader of the Turkish Republic. Both her father and her mother, Marguerite, my mother was a French woman, were modern in the sense of the day, which is to say they were committed to the education of their daughter as well as their son. And in the 1930s, Suzanne Campagna, this picture was taken in the late 1930s, was sent to Paris to continue her education. And lived in Paris throughout the occupation, as a matter of fact. She was a woman of style and class. She was also a student of pharmacy and earned a degree in pharmacy. In 1944, she became acquainted with a young American officer by the name of Gerard Campagna, who spoke fluent French and was serving with liberation forces in Paris as a translator. And a year after the liberation of Paris, Suzanne Campagna and Gerard Campagna were married. And this picture actually is from their wedding day in Paris. Following their marriage, they moved to New England and specifically Boston, where Gerard Campagna enrolled as a PhD student in history. And he would go on to write his PhD dissertation on the foreign policy of the Turkish Republic. They stayed here in Boston until the early 1950s, when Gerard Campagna became an analyst and, over time, the leading analyst of Turkey, working for the government. He continued to work for the government for nearly 20 years. Unfortunately, he died in 1988. Gerard Campagna is also honored in the name of the lecture series, Campagna-Kerven, a lecture series on modern Turkey. His wife, Suzanne, was a remarkable woman. She was very much involved in civic affairs in Washington, where they lived. She was involved with the League of Women Voters. She was very much committed to civil rights. She was very much committed to hands-on improvement of public school education in Washington, and spent a great deal of time working to that end. She was a woman of indomitable spirit. I remember years later, after the September 11th bombings, Suzanne was on one of the first trains running from Washington to New York so she could see the damage herself. At that point, she was in her early 80s. She was not a woman easily held back. She had a really fine mind. She attracted younger friends. She had a whole legion of friends who were 20, 30, 40 years her junior. When I met her, going on 25 years ago, she was very much intent on improving public knowledge of Turkey. And we had long conversations about how we might do that. Those conversations were the origins, actually, of this lecture series. And thanks to her generosity, we were able to launch the lecture series and continue it all of these years. Suzanne was a person who, if she was invited to a conference, it was through taking very, very careful notes, asking bright questions of speakers. In fact, I remember being at one meeting in Washington that she was attending, and she asked a series of speakers, you know, these very, very penetrating questions. And not one, but two of them came up to me and said, Where does that woman teach? Is she a professor someplace and so on? She was just someone who was very self-informed and very, very engaged. She visited BU often. She often made the trip in the spring for the lecture until health prevented that beginning a few years ago. She and I were together on a trip to Paris in 2009, she became very seriously ill, and I was able, after a few weeks, to get her back to the States. And I was so relieved to have her back at her home in Washington and so on. We were having the Campagna-Kerven lecture in about 3 weeks, and in 3 weeks' time, Suzanne showed up. Unbelievable. Just really indomitable. So I'd like to indulge your patience to simply express my wonderment and gratitude for having known this woman, and my thanks to her for having contributed in such a substantial way to Boston University. Unfortunately, Suzanne passed away last August, and I was close to, it didn't quite reach the 100-year mark. I'm very humbled to be able to tell you that in her estate, she made provisions for this lecture series to be funded in perpetuity. And in addition, she's also provided for the establishment of a PhD fellowship for students working on PhD topics related to modern Turkey. And as those of you who teach know, those fellowships are enormously important. They really make it possible for PhD programs to operate. So I really have to express again my gratitude to her for remembering us in this way. If you join me for a short moment of silence, I would be grateful. So thank you, Madame Suzanne Campagna. It's my pleasure now to introduce my colleague, Roberta McAuliffe, who is going to introduce the speaker. A few years back, we were intent on hiring the very finest professor of Turkish that we could find. And I was privileged to be on that search committee. And there was a certain Roberta McAuliffe teaching in Utah. And thankfully, we were able to attract her eastward. And she has established the program on the modern Turkish language at Boston University. Her students are very obviously inspired by her as a teacher, by her love of the language, and by her broad interest in Turkish culture, issues of gender, and so on. So she is quite a valued colleague. She's also the head of the Middle East and North Africa program. And I'm very happy that she has agreed to introduce our speaker this evening. Roberta, please.
I too would like to start by expressing how thankful I am for having met Suzanne Campagna, a wonderful, wonderful woman, and my gratitude for her having established this lecture series. And thank you to Richard Norton for that lovely introduction. So now, it is my pleasure to introduce Professor Resat Kasaba, whose works I've been familiar with for many, many years. He is the Stanley D. Golub Chair and Professor of International Studies and Director of the Henry M. Jackson School of International Studies at the University of Washington. His main area of interest has been the Ottoman Empire, Turkey, and the modern Middle East. He has written on economic history, state-society relations, migration, ethnicity, nationalism, and urban history. He edited volume 4 of the Cambridge History of Modern Turkey, and he wrote a groundbreaking book titled A Movable Empire, Ottoman Empire, Migrants and Refugees. And I see many of my students in the audience. If you haven't read it yet, you must read it. This book won the Fuat Köprülü Award in 2010. It examines the history of the Ottoman Empire through a new lens, focusing on the migrant groups that lived within its bounds and their changing relationship to the state's central authorities. It covers the entire span of the Ottoman Empire to the present, something few scholars can do with such impeccable expertise and virtuosity. He looks at the empire not only from the point of view of statistics and archival information, but also the lives of the people living in the empire. He received grants from the Andrew Mellon Foundation, Social Science Research Council, and the National Science Foundation. But in addition to being a fantastic scholar, grant winner, he's also a gifted teacher. In 1999, he was the recipient of the University of Washington's Distinguished Teaching Award. We are fortunate to have him here tonight to help us understand today's Turkey by taking a long view. His talk entitled Impossible Journeys from Past to Future and Back Again is sure to be amazing. So I will pass the floor on to Professor Kasaba.
Thank you very much. It is a pleasure to be here among friends and also hearing about Madame Campagna's life. This is something that I'm really interested in my ongoing work too, about these people who found themselves in these very transformative periods in history, and then making the most of these moments of change and then living a very meaningful and full life. It is extraordinary, really. It's an honor for me to be part of this lecture series. So, Roberta suggested that I will help you understand what's going on in Turkey. I can just start by saying I wish. It is very interesting. There are a lot of interesting things going on. So I'll try to put things into a perspective and perhaps end with some observations about what this moment in modern Turkey's history may mean in the long term. Now, everything that has to do with modern Turkey nowadays starts with President Recep Tayyip Erdogan, and usually it ends with President Recep Tayyip Erdogan. We will start with him. We may not end with him, but his presence in Turkey has become so big and so defining that I think it is you can't just escape with some observations about what's happening. It has become quite fashionable, I should say, or common to blame him for everything that's going on in Turkey lately, and especially things that are not going so well. And I think there's some truth to this. He has in the last, I would say, especially since the Gezi events in 2014, he has become increasingly divisive in his policies, in his manner of speech, and in particular, the speed with which he takes offense at anything that is even mildly critical about any of his policies or any of the policies of his government. Since 2014, 1,500 people have been investigated, nearly 100 held in custody for defaming the president in Turkey. It's so much so that, as I'm sure some of you know, he has managed to persuade Angela Merkel to prosecute a German comedian for making fun of him. Now, what makes this somewhat peculiar is that here we are also witnessing a very interesting transformation, a reversal, if you will. Now, Recep Tayyip Erdogan started his political life as a very, I would say, successful mayor of Istanbul in 1990s. My colleague Jenny White wrote a very interesting book about the early organization of the political party and his administration in 1990s. And then, so that's the origins of his political life. And then just a few years ago, he was still seen as a liberal Democrat, as a probably an example for other countries in the Middle East. He was described as a moderate Islamist. This is from Newsweek, a steadfast advocate of secular democracy and one of the world's most influential leaders. So this is an interesting reversal. But the point is that this is not the first reversal that modern Turkish history has experienced. In 1958, Daniel Lerner, in his very important book, claimed that the creation of new Turks and modern Turkey could be stopped only by a cataclysmic event similar to an atomic war. He thought that the direction that Turkey had embarked on in 1958 was completely determined and irreversible. But as we know, 2 years after he wrote that book, Turkey experienced first in a series of military coups that would really define most of especially the 20th century history of Turkey. And each one of these coups, of course, involved tragic events, hanging of a popularly elected prime minister and two ministers, imprisoning and torture and murder of student leaders, etc. And each one of these coups, I will submit, through Turkey's progress decades back. So that was an interesting reversal. But when you come to 1988, we seem to be yet again in a more promising kind of place in Turkish history. The Economist in 1987 claimed that Turkey was getting ready for Europe, and shortly thereafter, It described the country as the star of Islam. Yet in 1997, just a few years after these, an article about Turkey was headlined, "The Increasing Loneliness of Being Turkey." So these are, of course, years of my student years and my early years as a professor and trying to follow Turkey in those times, but almost you really got dizzy trying to see, like trying to find a framework of understanding a positive path, which was reversed very quickly, then reversed again. Most recently, 2010, Turkey rises. It's carving out a unique centrist role in a divided world, said. Lonely planet, said Istanbul is hot, and we are not talking about the weather. These days there are more happening, restaurants, bars, galleries, and clubs around town, etc. This is, again, early 2010s. The country had one of the highest rates of growth in those years, compared very favorably with most of the countries in Europe and other emerging market countries, and of course was accepted as a candidate member to the European Union in 2004. So it looked like things were once again set on a positive path. But again, reversal came, and most recently now we are reading articles about whether Turkey should be expelled from NATO. And The Economist is not describing Tayyip Erdogan as a moderate liberal, they used to call him mildly Islamist political leader, but as the Sultan of modern Turkey. Why are these swings? Where do they come from? How can we make sense of this pendulum-like character of Turkey's modern history? I think this is an important question because this pattern suggests that contrary to the expectations of many writers, thinkers, politicians, including Mustafa Kemal, Turkey's modern history perhaps did not consist of a linear progress. That this history perhaps is cyclical. And maybe, just maybe, for Turkey and maybe for some other countries in that position, for all kinds of reasons that I will say a few things about, being in between, being stuck, may very well be the normal state of things. Maybe this is Turkey's specific path to modernity. Let us see if we can make sense of this and if we can explain this situation. Now, as we all know, starting in the early decades of the 20th century, Turkey embarked on a journey. And this journey was supposed to take this country from an old empire, declining empire, to a modern nation state. And this journey actually started in the 1920s, but continued through the 20th century and had three key components I think we should remember. The first of these is the one that more and more people are writing about now, and that was the attempt to shape this society, late Ottoman, early Turkish society, into a nationally homogeneous and secular community. The second was the transforming this entity from an empire into a republic and eventually a democracy. And the third of this important transformation is the transforming Turkish economy from a state-centered, state-directed economic system into a market-centered economic system. Now, one of the points I'm going to try and make here this afternoon is that each and every one of these journeys ended up being somewhat incomplete. In the end, the Turkish transformation in all these three areas ended up being more formal than substantive, And in each one of these areas, we ended up with a state of incompleteness. Let's just go over these quickly. The first is this transformation of a society into a nationally coherent, homogeneous, secular community. Now, this was a shift from imperial diversity and heterogeneity to a sense of national identity and unity. This is perhaps the most difficult part of the transformation for people to understand. Let's go back to early 20th century and remember that what happened in those lands in those years was, just describe them as traumatic, I think would be understatement. There were about 13 million people left in the lands that became Turkey. And these people, this community had lost the religious and ethnic diversity that had defined, described it for many, many centuries. So most of the people who were left were rural, they were Muslims, they were illiterate, impoverished, wounded, orphaned, alone, and they had been in a continuous state of war since 1911, so more than 10 years. So this was a land, not only it was empty in large parts, but it was physically destroyed. Just to give you a sense of what this place was like, I just want to read you a brief passage from Şevket Süreyya Aydemir's memoirs from 1918. Aydemir became an intellectual leader in early Turkish Republic, and in 1918, as part of the Ottoman army during World War I, he was teaching the recruits, cadets, the basic sort of skills and language, etc., as the war was going on. So he walks into the classroom to talk to new recruits the first day, and he asks them, he says, "What is our religion?" And he says, "I thought they would say, 'Thank God we are all Muslims.' But no, some said they belong to the religion of the great Imam. Others, the religion, they said their religion is the religion of Ali. Some could not answer at all. And a few did say they were Muslims. When I asked who is our prophet, the answers got very confusing. One said, 'Our prophet is Enver Pasha.' And I said, 'Is our prophet dead or alive?' Things got really out of control. It seemed like some were waiting for others to respond and repeat what they were hearing. Those who said the prophet is alive, I asked where he lives. There were many different answers. Some said Istanbul, some said Mecca, some said Damascus. And to those who said the prophet is dead, I asked, 'When did he die?' They were even more confused. 100 years ago, 500 years ago, and one person said 1,000 years ago. Next day, in the next day, I asked them what our nationality is. They could not answer. When I asked, 'Aren't we Turkish?' they got agitated. 'God forbid, no,' they said. Even though, and Aydemir says, Turkish identity was becoming our last resort for survival, for those people, Turkishness was equivalent to being a Kızılbaş. So this was the context in which the society got to be transformed. And under the leadership of Atatürk, after the end of Turkish-Greek War in 1922, these deeply scarred people of Anatolia came to be defined as Turks. They were accorded a history that stretched back to Central Asia for millennia, and at some points placed Turks and Turkey at the center of whole entire human civilization. But in this context, who came to be defined as Turkish was not easy. On the face of it, all Turks were Muslims, since almost all the Christians had been killed, expelled, or marginalized in this society. Yet roughly 10% of this population considered themselves to be Kurdish. They had a distinct language and culture, common historical experience, and had been in these parts longer than any other group. And they certainly did not have any interest in calling themselves anything else but either their tribal affiliations or Kurds in general. And for the rest, Turkishness was not something they could identify with, because there were also a lot of refugees and immigrants from the Balkans and from other parts of the former Ottoman lands. The new Turkish state embarked on a comprehensive policy of inculcation, this newly invented identity, and the forceful assimilation of those who claim to be other things, especially Kurds. The use of other languages was banned. Thousands of people in Eastern Anatolia were relocated to the West. The names of the villages were changed. And any sign, any trace of Kurdish identity and culture and history was attempted to be erased from the region. It is not surprising that within a year of the establishment of the new state, Kurds took up armed struggle against the state to defend their way of life. The state response was vehement. Villages in the east were bombed by Turkish planes, scores of people were killed, and the leaders of the uprising were either captured or executed. None of these, however, proved to be real solutions. Neither did the policy of assimilation work very well. With ebbs and flows, the struggle between Kurds and the Turkish state continued throughout the history of modern Turkey. Between 1923 and today, it is hard to find a stretch that is longer than 10 years when there is no conflict between these two entities in Turkey. The other aspect of the societal transformation, of course, was the religious transformation. That is, transforming a religious, basically a Muslim community, fitting them into a secular model. Now, this also was a very complicated task because most of the people who were in Anatolia in 1923 were Muslims. And under the new circumstances, there was little doubt that in order to be a real Turk, you had to be a Hanafi Sunni Muslim. Following the orthodox definitions of Islam, Alevi Muslims in Turkey, who constituted almost 25% of the population, were not recognized as a distinct group or were marginalized. The small number of non-Turks, Jewish, non-Muslims, Jewish, Greek, and Armenian, and other communities were openly treated as second-class citizens. There were clear limits to how far they could advance in government bureaucracy, elected to offices, or serve in what capacity in the military. They were subjected to periodic campaigns of harassment because of their backgrounds, and they were also targeted in 1942 with a specially designed tax law that all but bankrupted most of them. However, even though the Hanafi Islam was the de facto feature of being Turkish, expressing this publicly, displaying signs, clothing, and other symbols were banned and criminalized. Not agreeing to wear the Western style hat could cost you very heavily, even your life. Because the new Turkish Republic emerged as one of the most strictly secular regimes in the world, Atatürk believed that religion, especially Islam, to be a major obstacle in the path of progress and development, and he genuinely believed that Turkish nation would progress and join, in his words, the rank of the contemporary civilized nations only with the help of a radically secular political system. Perhaps the journey, as it was imagined, was impossible. This notion of a secular modern Turkish identity was more of an ideal than a reality. It was conceived and designed by a small urban elite and imposed onto the whole country. And it was a far cry from what was going on in the society. The conception and imposition of secularism in Turkey poisoned the relationship between the country's ruling elite and a large majority of its people for generations to come. I think it is this wedge that the Justice and Development Party has been manipulating so skillfully as it firmly identified itself as the voice of those people who were silenced and excluded. No election, no demonstration or protest is likely to bridge this gap very easily. In the 9+ elections it has participated, the share of this party, Justice and Development Party, has never dropped below 40%, which it seems roughly the party's base, which was created in the early years of the Republic. So those were the sort of the societal journey, the transformation in terms of religion and nationality. And the next journey I want to say a few things about is political, and that is a transition from empire to republic, and also from a single party regime to a multi-party democracy in 1946. The establishment of the republican regime, as we well know now, was very closely related to Atatürk's really determination to marginalize all his rivals that were the remnants of the Young Turk movement in early decades. So that was a radical departure. It was important for establishing his political authority. And similarly, the transition to a multi-party system in 1946 was closely related to the various conversations and competitions among the political elite in Turkey, and in particular also related to Turkey's emerging relationship with Western democracies and NATO after World War II. Now the point I think that's becoming every day more and more clear in Turkey is that neither the establishment of the republic nor the transition to a multi-party democracy was accompanied by the creation of independent, autonomous civil society organizations, and most importantly, with institutional protection of social, political, and civil rights in Turkey. Yes, there are regular elections in Turkey where you don't know the outcome and you never get 99.9% of the vote in one direction, but that's about it. Today, 70 years after the coming of a multi-party system, Turkey still is a country where the university presidents, judges, and prosecutors are appointed by the government. National police is administered centrally by the Ministry of Internal Affairs. Turkish constitution or the many laws that are on the books do not provide any real protection of freedom of speech or assembly, or obviously protection of the rights of the minorities. I think the weakness and in fact the absence of institutions make the democratic regime in Turkey vulnerable still. It used to be it was vulnerable to the military's interventions and coups, but now I think it's obvious that it is also vulnerable to the emerging civilian authoritarian regime that we are witnessing. The next journey I want to say a few things about is the journey that affected the economy, and that is the transition to a market economy. This transition, of course, was initiated in 1980, but it really gained steam after the military coup that came in 1980, late in 1980 in September. It involved initially the lowering of barriers to trade, removing the controls over financial markets, and shifting the industrialization model in Turkey from a state-centered import substitution model to a new model that was that emphasized export promotion. Now, this transformation was shaped by first Prime Minister, then President Turgut Özal's strong personality and determination. Özal was really Turkey's first truly civilian president. But it was the military regime that came in 1980 and continued in 1983 was necessary for this transformation, because it was only under that military regime that the labor unions were silenced, any possibility of protest was prevented, but most importantly, any means of societal protection from the market was made impossible. This is a point that one of the, I think, the most sort of brilliant minds who wrote about society in right after World War II, interwar years and World War II, Karl Polanyi, mentioned in his book Great Transformation, when he said that even the freest markets require institutional protection. The notion that markets are a natural thing is a myth. They are created by institutions and they have to be protected by institutions. And society's protection against the market is the natural part of this relationship. But in Turkey, that societal protection was made very weak from the beginning, and in 1980, it was all but eliminated. So, in Turkey then, just like its democracy, market economy was also very vulnerable. It quickly became, after 1980, a rent-generating mechanism for a political elite. This economy was neither new nor liberal. So to call it neoliberal, I think, is not very accurate either. And 1980s also ushered in an era that witnessed a tremendous polarization in income in Turkey, in income distribution and wealth, and increased poverty. And most significantly, it did not necessarily reduce the role of the government. So, looking at the 12 years when the Justice and Development Party has been in power, it has not really moved Turkey farther along any of these paths. Initially, there were signs that suggested that things could be moving in the right direction. There were some reforms in the political system that, I think, for a good reason, for a good cause, eliminated, in fact, reduced the influence of military in Turkish politics. There was a serious opening towards Kurds that included more freedom in the use of language, education, etc., and representation. And there was a technocratic discipline that brought economic growth to Turkey that was managed not so badly in early 2000s. And based on these reforms, as I said earlier, Turkey became a candidate member of European Union in 2004. But now in recent years, as I started my talk, as I said in the beginning of my talk, things once again seem to be rolling back. Turkey today looks like, Turkish government looks like, it's fighting against its own civil society organizations. In fact, it's fighting against a segment of its Muslim constituency. And of course, once again, the fight against Kurds has flared up. Since only last summer, more than 1,000 Kurdish fighters and more than 200 security personnel have been killed. Several cities in the Kurdish region of Turkey have been placed under prolonged periods of curfew. Roadside bombs and main highways and bombings of main government and security offices have become common in the Kurdish region of the country. Turkish economy has taken a turn for the worse. After this period of quite impressive growth and expansion, now its growth rate has gone down from all the way up 9% to 3% into 2015. And the US dollar was about 1.75 in 2013, now it's almost 3. To a dollar. Foreign debt has gone up, and in the absence of institutional support in Turkey in terms of research and development, Turkish economy, Turkish industries turned out to have no basis in invention that could really, really manage this transition from an economy that is based on services to an economy that is really based on industrial growth in the 21st century. And one of the things about what happened in Turkish economy under especially Justice and Development Party is that it has become very much centered around the government and the people who are close to the government. And the economist describes this as an economy that is not a know-how economy, it is a know-who economy. And it is, the government's presence is so big that government actually uses its economic tools to fight against its rivals who may be owning big conglomerates and companies in Turkey. So, when you look at it today, in 2016, there is a sense that Turkey is becoming a dangerous place for journalists, academics, Kurds, and ordinary people. There has been, as you know, since last summer, a number of major bombings in Ankara and in Istanbul. And these have become increasingly big in their impact. And they were, some of these were staged by Kurds, and some of these were staged by forces that are affiliated with Islamic State. And what is also interesting is that the Turkish government, police, and intelligence forces seem utterly incapable of preventing such attacks. I've read, for example, that Ankara did not have a fully appointed security chief, police chief, for Ankara, that's the capital city, at the time when the most recent bombing took place, because the government was not sure about the loyalty of various people who could be appointed to that position. So this is a country now that is very polarized. And it is a country where people are finding it easier and easier to attack each other on the basis of their ethnic or religious background and identity. Now, I have to say, and I'm not going to talk, or we can cover this in Q&A, but it is, I know and I'm aware that some of these difficulties that Turkey is living through is happening in a very explosive environment in the region that is determined by the collapse of the Syrian state, continuing chaos in Iraq, and the rise of the Islamic State. By any measure, this is probably one of the most challenging contexts one can imagine for the Middle East. But I also have to say that Turkey's foreign policy inadvertently contributed to some of that chaos, and now it's also one thing that is threatening the border areas especially. So, earlier predictions of people like Lerner or Atatürk, notwithstanding, Turkey appears to be incapable of taking the steps that are necessary to prosper in the 21st century. It simply lacks the institutions that would have provided its citizens with basic education and individual rights which modern states are supposed to provide. Here's some data I think that we should think about when we think about where Turkey is, where Turkey is likely to move. Turkey today ranks second to last among OECD countries in the percentage of 25 to 64-year-olds who has attended upper secondary education. And while the share of education has increased in Turkey's budgets over the recent years, a whopping 90% of this increase has gone to administrative budgets and salaries, with the share of investment in education itself has actually declined in this period. Another striking evidence comes from a research that was conducted at International Center for Advancement of Scientific Literacy at the University of Michigan. In a test that they conducted, to test the science literacy of adults in OECD countries, Turkey came in last, with only 1.5% of the respondents giving correct answers to 7 of the 10 basic science questions. And these are basic questions that has to do with gravity and the solar system, etc. The 2015 data on rule of law ranks Turkey 12th out of 13 in a region that extends from the Balkans to Central Asia. It is ranked 29th out of 31 in its income group and 80th out of 102 globally. And rule of law, according to this study, is a composite index that includes constraints on government powers, absence of corruption, open government, fundamental rights, order and security, regulatory enforcement, civil justice, and criminal justice. And also includes equal treatment, due process, freedom of expression, etc. And what is more alarming, between 2014 and 2015, Turkey's regional ranking has slipped from 10 out of 13 to 12 out of 13. Today, Turkey is ranked 84th out of 165 countries in terms of democracy index in 2010. And today, it has slipped from 84th to 98th place. So where does this leave us? Of course, Turkey does not find itself in this predicament because of a cultural flaw. This has nothing to do with religion. And Turkey does not find itself in this predicament because of one person, be it Erdogan or somebody else. I think what needs to be explained is why one person can be so effective in the way he can push buttons and pulls levers that always turns out to be right for him. I think Turkey finds itself in this position, and this is, I think, is the cumulative result of a series of bad and wrong decisions its leaders made or did not make over many decades. There has never been in Turkey a serious understanding of what that transition from empire to nation entailed. Even today, and I looked at this just 2 weeks ago, in the books that high school students read in Turkey, the lack of democracy in Turkey in the early 1920s and 30s is explained by referring to the uprisings that the Turkish government was having to deal with. So in other words, really putting the horse in front of the cart and saying that because of the uprisings, Turkey had to be undemocratic. Otherwise, it would have become much more inclusive. But I think also we should not forget that during the Cold War, the Western states, and especially the United States, in a way, at crucial points in time, enabled a succession of Turkish governments to continue in their misguided ways because of calculations that had to do with the region, the Cold War. So what mattered in that time more than anything was what Turkey remained a bulwark against the Soviet Union and communism. And today, I think it's troubling that in the interest of using Turkey as a stopgap in the migration crisis in the region, the European Union is getting ready to ignore the violations of individual and civil rights in Turkey. Now, different decisions and actions could have and could still open up new vistas and other directions. I know that such decisions, however, are not made in a vacuum. And also, they are made in a context that's shaped by forces that are beyond anybody's control. And sometimes, these circumstances can be especially trying. Now, but such periods of cataclysmic change also open up possibilities for bold, transformative initiatives. As we know, much hope was vested in Turkey, both after 9/11 and especially during the Arab Spring. Turkey then was the star of Islam. It was rising, and it was the hope for the region and beyond. It is obvious that Turkey did not live up to those big expectations, but I think that is because it lacked the foundation to do so. It is likely that Turkey will swing back. We may very well find ourselves in a situation where we will again talk about the hope of the region, a liberal democratic regime, a country that is rising, etc. But without addressing these foundational shortcomings and institutional problems that I mentioned, I am afraid such a swing will again be temporary and will be cut back and move the country in the opposite direction once again. Thank you very much. This is where I end. And
as you formulate your questions, I would like to take a moment after this wonderful and insightful tour de force to thank some of the institutions that co-sponsored this lecture this year, starting with the College of Arts and Sciences, the Pardee School at Boston University, the Institute for the Study of Muslim Societies and Civilizations, the Institute for Iraqi Studies, as well as BCARS. BCARS is the Boston Consortium on Arab Region Studies, and this is the Carnegie Initiative, which is based at Northeastern, but has cooperated very closely with Boston University. It's headed by Dennis Sullivan, who's here tonight. So thank you to all these co-sponsors, and I'm grateful for that level of support, and I'm sure you are as well. Before we take a question from the floor, I'd like to pick up on your comment about the regression in the status of the judiciary. There have been some remarkable revelations in Turkey about corruption, reaching into the family, reaching into the household of then Prime Minister Erdogan, his son, as I remember. Why have these accusations of corruption failed to stick? It would seem, given who Erdogan is, given who its constituency is, however he might be revered, this level of personal corruption would be something that would really undermine and undercut his status.
I think there are two reasons. I think on one level, the fact that those accusations, which actually included actual recording of some conversations that did not leave any room for imagination, really. Despite that, the fact that Erdogan was able to use this crisis in a way to really start this war against basically the Gulen movement, which was an important partner for him for most of its early phase of its political life, shows, I think, is a very clear demonstration of how weak the institutions are in Turkey. Perhaps it's something that people didn't think about it that much, but the inability of judiciary to really take these accusations and start an independent investigation, and the absence of a kind of a culture, I should say, that would allow that investigation to proceed and then reach a conclusion independently, shows us, I think, the weakness of these institutions. The other part of the answer, I think, has to do with Erdogan's personality. And here, I think, no matter what, the segment of the population that I mentioned that had been excluded from power for many, many decades in Turkey, in the eyes of them, he is a very special person. I think he's revered, and his charisma is like nothing that we think about when we talk about charisma. And people are willing to believe that this is in fact a conspiracy that was created to weaken him, to fight with him. And that belief, that tie, I think really
has to be, we have to keep that in mind. There is nothing, I think, that can happen that could break that tie very easily in Turkey. And what he has done is that rather than using that basis to branch out and include others, he is increasingly relying almost exclusively on that basis, I think, which really, in the absence of other kinds of institutions, makes judiciary weaker and other institutions even weaker.
Yet, ironically, ensures a narrow base for the regime.
Yes.
Yeah,
yes.
40%
yes.
or so.
Yes, exactly.
Said. Please, what are your questions? Yes. Yes. Hi.
Thank you very much. It was. Oh, thank you. Yes. Thank you very much, Çiğdem Benam. I think that was one of the most balanced and insightful talk I've, you know, listened to about Turkey for so long. Because a lot of times, I think I agree that we have, you know, we focus too much maybe on Erdogan, and then we forget some of the things. But my question is actually, since you are the expert, you know, about the transition from empire to a nation state, and my question is, are we now experiencing a transition back to another empire? So this is, I mean, this is not really like taking it literally, but in terms of nation building practices, and you talked about, you know, how Sunni Islam was emphasized and a lot of things. Now, Sunni Islam is still there, but Turkey's relationship with Kurds have transformed, and sometimes we forget actually AKP is the party still, you know, receiving majority of the votes from the Kurdish region. And also, like, foreign policy has, you know, it had a lot of elements of liberalism, but it could be interpreted as a new sort of empire where you try to kind of blur the borders. So I was, you know, curious to hear your opinion.
Well, you know, again, there is, I think there is this, as we know, on the part of AKP, Justice and Development Party, there is an infatuation with the Ottoman Empire and, you know, the palace and the whole, you know, kind of the symbols that people are really emphasizing. I think on one level, I mean, I don't presume to be, you know everything about the Ottoman history or whatever. From what I know and from what my colleagues, even better historians, know, that all of this is based on a very faulty, weak, misguided knowledge about the Ottoman Empire. It is, I think that's also, I think what you're seeing is what people who are leading the country now learned in schools about the Ottoman Empire, which is not very accurate on many levels. One thing that was, you know, important to realize about the Ottoman Empire is that throughout its history, it was a really not a very centralized political system of any kind. It was diverse. I mean, it wasn't really a, you know, haven for everybody, and it wasn't really, we're not talking about equal treatment under law, anything like that. But there were a lot of people of different ethnicities and religions that lived in these lands for many, many years. Not because, you know, Ottoman rulers were particularly nice, but it was pragmatic to keep it that way. And it really worked to the benefit of the communities and the empire itself. It was an arrangement that was a lot looser. And on many levels, it was, you know, it ended up being much more tolerant than what came later for some people. So the Justice and Development Party may have some imperial ambitions, but I think their imperial ambitions are very, as I said, are based on faulty understanding of what it was, what. You know, how Ottoman Empire is seen in other parts, or just seeing it just as a way of exerting power and influence in the region. So I guess there might be an interest in going back, but I think the direction of this going back, I think, is really is not very clear.
So.
Thank you very much for this excellent talk. My name is Hikmet Kocamanash. So piggybacking on that question, so a lot of observers and analysts consider what's going on in the last 10 years as the creation of a so-called new Turkey or a post-Kemalist Turkey or a third republic. Would you agree with that assessment? And if you agree, I was wondering, comparing the First Republic or the early Turkish Republic to what's going on right now, what I observe is that maybe politically we have the carving of a new state system that's going on. However, in contrast to the early Republic, we do not have a certain kind of state elite and the creation of a certain bourgeoisie that is parallel to what was going on in the early Republic in terms of culture, the creation of new intellectuals. Do you also see some sort of a lack in that regard in terms of the cultivation of a certain bourgeoisie based on certain intellectual elites? Thank you.
Yeah, I think they are very good points, and a lot can be said about them. But let me just say that perhaps there are two periods. I think there's no doubt that the rise of first Refah Party and the municipalities, etc., and eventual Justice and Development Party, and that transition, I think, does represent a new phase in Turkey's political history. On a very simple level, like I tried to say in my talk, that does represent the integration, inclusion of a vast majority of people who were excluded. They voted, but they voted, on the basis of local power relations and political bosses, etc. So there is that opening. So the basis of Turkish democracy changed. So in that sense, and if you add to this the eventual, kind of elimination of militaries, constitutional or legal presence in Turkish politics, all of this does represent a new republic. So you can describe it as post-Kemalist, etc., but it is a new republic. But I think what we're seeing in the last less than 10 years, I think, is actually an emergence of a new elite that doesn't seem to be that different in its behavior, in terms of its relationship to politics, etc., an exclusive nature. Intolerance of opposition, and it does have its own intellectuals. I mean, you may call them pseudo-intellectuals, but they are, they do provide the intellectual basis for this new elite. So there is in an interesting kind of way, a post-Kemalist system is really starting to take perhaps not the better but the worse elements of what is described as Kemalist system. And one thing I should say this at this point perhaps is the whole relationship with Gulen movement is very important here. It's a part of this, obviously. What has happened is a marginalization of the Gulen movement, and this conflict that's going on between the party and the Gulen movement meant that some of the better educated and competent bureaucrats, administrators, etc., are no longer working for the government. And that's, I think, part of the reason why you're seeing, for example, even if they have the intelligence that an attack is likely to happen in Ankara, they don't have the structure, the means to deal with it. And I think that is really a very unfortunate development also.
On the side, yes, please.
Thank you again for an excellent overview of the.
Thank you.
Can I do it without this? Yeah, thank you again for an excellent overview of the.
If you reduce the mic, because we're taping the event.
Okay. I see.
And okay. Otherwise, we'll lose your question.
I'll do that. I wanted to ask you a little bit about you. So you talked about the importance of institutions and the incompetence of the judiciary. I've been following the Turkish Constitutional Court over the past few years, and they've issued a number of important rulings that have sort of challenged the government on a number of issues, you know, one of them being the closure of the dershanes, the other one being the banning of YouTube, and most recently the release of the two journalists, Can Dündar. And I wonder, what would be your assessment of what is really going on in the Constitutional Court?
Yes.
The AKP portrays them as sort of being taken over by the Gulenists, and there are still a few justices left from the secularist time post the AKP, before the AKP. But I wonder, this is a puzzle in my mind, and I wonder if you have a good explanation or an interpretation of what might be the case.
Yes. Thank you. I don't think, we shouldn't really think about any of the institutions in any setting, including Turkey, as, black or white, weak or strong. They're always, these are settings for where different groups compete with each other for power. It's obvious that, you can marginalize people, you can fire people, but institutions always have this kind of dynamic in it. So they always have divisions. So I think you're seeing in part the competition still among people with different ideas. So when you think about the state as a whole, of course, that's also, it's never a monolithic institution. You always have these groups trying to shape state policies in different ways. But even then, when you look at the Turkish case, the Constitutional Court, it is possible, people can kind of start talking about changing sort of the members, for example, number of members, how they're appointed, and increasing the number appointed by the president, etc. The possibility of manipulating the, the mechanisms that govern these institutions, the ease with which the political authority can do that, I think, points to the weakness I was talking about. But even in that context, I think you will always see these ongoing conflict, because these institutions are people with different political views and education and background try to shape them.
Can I ask a quick follow-up on that? Would you see the recent sort of packing of the court then? Would that be your interpretation of it, or would you see it as more of a democratizing court in terms of increasing?
I wouldn't see it as necessarily democratizing. I don't. Yeah. I mean, you may like the people who are being appointed, but it doesn't really, I think, change the impact of the manner in which the appointments are being made.
Listen back.
Hi. Thank you for the great talk. That was really interesting. My name is Claire Sadar, and I was wondering if you could perhaps speculate on the impact of the Syrian refugees and other refugees coming into Turkey, and as they increasingly settle into society and it becomes increasingly obvious that they're not leaving, what kind of political impact that could have, both nationally and locally?
Well, thank you for asking that question, because first I want to say that leaving Turkey aside, what is described as this refugee crisis, and it is a crisis, it is now, I think it is the worst humanitarian crisis that the world is witnessing, definitely since World War II. The numbers are huge, and people who are displaced from Syria, it's really, you can't but feel horrible when you see young people, young children being swept into the shores and whatnot. And I feel, I'm speechless in a way. I don't understand why there isn't a reaction in the world that is humanitarian to this issue, that does not have anything to do with religion, has anything to do with the countries and with the identity of people. It is the human beings, it's a humanitarian crisis. Instead, I think, as you know, it has become a tool for politicians to compete with each other in Europe and also, unfortunately, in this country. So it's not a humanitarian crisis in the discourse of people now. This is a threat. It's seen as a threat, and instead of mobilizing to help these people, countries seem to be interested in protecting themselves from them. And I think this is really very hard to understand, and I'm positive, this is being recorded even, years from now when people look back at this period and people will wonder how is it that the reaction was not different. So that is really my two cents, and that's how I feel about the whole issue. Very depressing. For Turkey, you know, a lot of things are wrong in Turkey, and I tried to talk about them a little bit. People sometimes forget that Turkey now has the largest number of refugees in the world, period. I mean, anywhere, there's no other country that has more refugees than Turkey has. It's more than 2.5 million. And also, all but 200,000 of these people are in the society itself. Only about 200,000 are in camps. And despite this, and this has happened in a short period of time, 4 or 5 years at the most, there has not been in Turkey a mass hysteria or reaction or demonstrations. Occasionally there are episodic things, but I think that is something that people should really realize that that's, you know, something positive that I think we should really keep in mind in terms of this. But when you look closely, of course, these, especially with the possibility of Syria either becoming whole again or being in a situation to reabsorb these people, it seems more and more remote. There are some tensions in Turkey, of course. These people are very open to be exploited. Thousands of children are missing. People are being employed in very bad conditions, in sweatshops and in places like that. They have no way of asking for their rights, demanding their rights. And the more the situation continues, I think the more difficult it will be for them. So that is, it is Syria crisis, I think, is something that is not only threatening the region, it's threatening European Union. You know, it is something that I think has to be handled on a level that is appropriate to its scale. And so far it's not being done.
Shall we take two more questions before the reception, please?
Thank you for a most insightful talk. But since you started at the very beginning, it's like it was a shaky ground. And coming all the way up to the modern Turkey right now, it's like, to me, it's looking like putting up a modern building on an earthquake zone. If you had a magic hat on, what would you do? What would you say? Where is the hope?
Not only for Turkey, but I think for most countries in the Middle East, I think the hope is with the young people. Turkey is one of the countries that is most highly integrated into social media. This means that there is a vast body kind of in Turkey, young people who are very much aware of what's going on in the world. They're very connected to the rest of the world, and they have counterparts in other parts of the region and the world that they're in communication with. We don't really know the impact of this now because it's very new, but I think that is a whole reality that is not immediately visible, and I think it manifested itself brilliantly during the Arab Spring. People now tend to think about those as really almost like an accident of history, and we're back to where we were. But I don't necessarily believe that. The fact that they happened, the way they happened, shows us that there's a lot that's brewing under. I think that is my very short answer is that the young people, in terms of looking forward, in terms of being hopeful. Otherwise, other kinds of interventions, like I tried to say, may change things, improve things, but that would only be periodic. I mean, it won't be permanent, temporary.
Before we take another question, I'm going to push you a little bit on this
yes.
point, if I may. One of the axioms, if you will, of your talk was about the weakness of civil society in Turkey. Mm-hmm. And if we take the example of the Arab Spring, we certainly saw an inspiring mobilization of youth across the Arab world. But there was very little organization undergirding that mobilization. Is there any evidence that you know of that Turkish youth is beginning to organize in ways that might be economically or politically meaningful?
Mm-hmm. Well, in some ways, yes. What I'm not exactly sure, and I simply don't know how extensive the networks that people are parts of go, or are we talking about competing networks that are not necessarily capable of working together. But, you know, when you look and when you go and hear and read about these things, they do seem some very vibrant networks that are organized on particular issues and places and, you know, fields and specializations. So there is that, but what I don't know is their connections to each other.
Because if we think about the Gezi Square demonstrations
yeah.
in which youth
yeah.
played a very significant part,
right.
much of that has been very, very
right.
dissipated.
Right. Right.
While the memory lingers, there
yes.
isn't really an organizational manifestation.
Yeah. And the memory, you're absolutely right, I think it is the fact that it happened. And again, the same thing is true in Egypt, I think. The fact that it happened, I think, becomes part of the country's, you know, kind of history in a way, mm-hmm. public memory. And it's bound to have an effect.
Please. We have a few more questions, so don't be deterred by the fact that I said two. We'll take a few more. Yeah.
Thank you, Rashad. Let me add my word of thanks for a really insightful lecture and discussion here. My question was about identity and European identity and where the state of play might be on that. I was struck that in your transformations, Europe didn't come up, or, you know, whether in the instrumental sense of EU membership, is that, for example, now
yes.
no longer relevant?
Yes.
And I was also struck when it did come up was when the question was asked here about the refugees. And it reminded me recently, I suggested to a group of students, wonderful students, and I asked, you know, which European country has the most refugees? This was at the height of when these boats were coming. And they guessed five different things, and I suggested Turkey, and I got a nearly violent reaction back.
Okay.
You know, how dare you suggest that? And it I'm exaggerating, but only for effect. And so partly how Europe sees Turkey and partly how Turkey sees its relationship with Europe. And if it's not EU, then where in the regional framework does it fit? I suspect it's not the Arab world that Turkey sees itself. Is it Asia? Probably not. Or does it not matter at all
yeah.
where that
yeah.
fits?
Yeah. Yeah. You know, this is, of course, a question, you know, I mean, that's always in our minds. There was, for most of, I would say, 1990s and early 2000s, not actually, I don't know how at that point in time or in that history, how probable or realistic was for Turkey to become a full member, I really don't know. But the possibility of membership played a very positive role in Turkey, and especially in domestic politics. I mean, a lot of the reforms that took place were done under the auspices of these negotiations that were going on. And there was always, you know, this, you know, making Turkish institutions conform to European laws, I think, was an important element. I don't think that's there anymore, unfortunately. And I think part of the blame lies with Europe. I think if European Union was more forthcoming in terms of Turkey's membership before the Syrian crisis, and in fact, if Turkey was more firmly as part of the European Union, I don't think this crisis would reach the level it did even. I think it would be easier for Europe to deal with this. But it was, so that didn't happen. And, you know, to put it very bluntly, I think European Union for most Turks now has lost some of its attraction. This came partly with the crisis that Greece has been in, economic crisis. People felt in Turkey that the ability of Turks to control their currency is not a bad thing, you know. And most recently, over this refugee issue, I think the way Europe has been trying to make Turkey a place to keep the refugees from entering into Europe, I think really puts Turkey in a very different category than a candidate member. No other country had to wait until it's been 12 years since Turkey was a candidate member. No other country has waited this long. Once a country is declared a candidate member, it usually takes a few years for it to become a full member. So here is Turkey again. Turkey was part of the negotiations in 1959 when the European Union was first being put together. You know, it was part of that network. So I think that's now, I really don't think it is in the cards. So what does that mean for Turkey's overall Western orientation? You know, it's a good question. I think it goes back to this earlier discussion about various groups in Turkey and all segments of Turkish political elite and also Turkish society. People have different visions for Turkey. I think there are people in Turkey in influential positions who would want to see a country that is much more Middle Eastern or, you know, kind of regional power that can be a bridge between East and West, but more comfortable with that regional culture. But there are people, and not a majority, obviously, but there are people who still see Turkey's, you know, primary orientation with Europe and with the West. It is really, I think it is one of the most important, you know, debates that are going on in Turkey. It's been going on for a long time, but in earlier times, it was really, I mean, the elite, the ruling elite was very powerful in its hold of power, and especially military, that this, you didn't see it as a consequential. There was no question that Turkey would be NATO, part of the West, etc. But right now, there are very powerful groups in Turkey who see a very different future for the country. And their argument is that the other one didn't work. You know, it's like, in a way, it's Republicans in this country when they say you went with all these moderate, you know, kind of middle-of-the-road Republicans and they don't get elected, so why don't try some extremist group? So it's, in a way, it's not, so their argument is that, I mean, you wanted to become Europe. Europe doesn't want you. They don't see you as a Western power, so why not try something else? And for the first time, I think this group, and not necessarily only people affiliated with the Justice and Development Party, is substantial, and they have, you know, they have a voice, and that's part of a debate that's going on in Turkey.
Now finally, yes. Not one, but two final questions, please.
Thank you. That was a very thought-provoking talk. So I'm I was wondering, since these cycles are ongoing and one step forward, 2 steps back, I was just wondering whether you could pick one of those many weak institutions that you mentioned and think about which one of them would be the most crucial to create any kind of change. I was like thinking of education, but maybe that's not it. I wanted to hear your view. And then as the second step, let's say that you had a pipeline to the ear of Brussels and the ear of Washington, and you could tell them, you know, that you need to do something to strengthen this particular institution. I mean, which institution needs to be strengthened the most to change anything? And how would you go about strengthening it? Not you personally, but any suggestions?
Yeah. Can I pick two or I have to pick one? So in the long term, I think there is no doubt in my mind that education is more important than anything else. And when I say education, it's not just, you know, it is really a strategic decision in terms of how you train people and for what you train people. And I think this is the decision that was made in some of the East Asian countries early in the 20th century. And now, of course, in places like Korea and Taiwan, you're seeing the results of that decision. So that takes a strategic decision, enormous amount of resources for a purpose, you know, and the purpose is really to train people to become, you know, kind of productive in this next century. So that is really, I think, very important. But in the shorter term, relatively shorter term, for the functioning of, you know, a society like Turkey, I think judiciary is very important. I think the confidence that people have in this country, again, there are a lot of problems, of course, that has to do with race, with politics, with all kinds of issues, and I'm aware of them. But when it comes down to it, there is a confidence in this country that courts work, you know. It is possible that a president can be impeached, etc. You know, there are limits to what a president can do. They can't even appoint a justice to the Supreme Court if, you know, there are other institutions that really block it. You know, there's nothing that. So I think that kind of strengthening judiciary is very important, and that's why I think working on the Constitutional Court is a good thing. But I think it's an important issue. So how I have to go about doing it, European Union or this country? I think, again, you know, there are good reasons why countries like the U.S. or European Union end up having to work with what they have, because they have their own shorter term interests that they want to protect and advance. And what they end up doing, of course, is that more and more work with the existing governments or, you know, whatever the institutions that exist, which serves the short-term interests of the European Union, of the United States, but it doesn't really do anything in terms of improving what's going on in Turkey. So what I think the world needs now, from the Syrian crisis to a lot of things that are going on in other parts of the world, is some kind of a global Marshall Plan. You know, this is a Pollyanna type of thing, maybe we're thinking about. But this is really also, you can think about the amount of money that's being spent for other purposes and how much difference that money would make in a different kind of, in a different kind of priorities. Now, none of this means that we can forget about the danger that is posed by, you know, organizations like Boko Haram and the Islamic State. That's a subject for a different talk, probably. But it's not, you know, I'm not thinking about this in a panacea for everything that's going on. But seeing what's happening. That kind of, again, going back to civil society, that societal kind of contributions or context, I think, would be very important.
Final question here. Gentleman in the blue shirt, yes. And if you have questions that haven't yet been addressed, you will have a chance during the reception to ask those, okay? Yes, sir.
So I guess I kind of wanted to build on Dean Najam's question, looking at how the West, Europe, and the rest of the NATO members have viewed Turkey culturally. I want to look at the strategic dimension. It seems because Turkey is strategically so important that a lot of criticism coming from the West has been muted in light of locking up journalists or what's going on in the southeast of the country right now. Is this going to reach a tipping point where there will be more criticism coming from the West that might damage the relationship between the West and Turkey? Or is this something that follows a pattern that's kind of gone through this pendulum swinging that you described earlier?
Yeah. I think it will be up to Turkey and other countries in the Middle East to address some of these issues, because I don't really expect, I mean, for one thing, it's well known that at least under President Obama, and then depends on who will be elected next elections, but the U.S. is really interested in taking away some of its focus from the Middle East, and then really this whole pivot to Asia, etc. I think it's a real interest on the part of, at least part of U.S. Foreign policy establishment. So it's likely that they will try to find ways of disentangling themselves even further from some of these commitments in the Middle East. So, regardless, until they do that, or as they do that, I think I don't really see them really going to any distance criticizing Turkey for what it's doing to its journalists. I mean, you will see some statements, you will see some editorials, but I don't think that is really what at least the U.S. sees as the best use of its influence right now. The president is in Saudi Arabia now, for example, and that's again, I mean, it's a, you know, there are a lot of interesting shades to that too. So I think it has to come from within, and that's why I think this kind of thinking about, you know, what the leaders decide and what their priorities are, and then what kind of institutions need to be strengthened. I mean, those are the debates these countries will have to have internally. Some of it, you know, I think is not against the U.S. interests or especially the European interests. I don't have any, you know, I'm confident that if Turkey wanted to move in a direction like that, it would find a lot of support from all kinds of organizations internationally, not necessarily governments, but NGOs, foundations. I mean, I live in Seattle. Our neighbor is Gates Foundation. I mean, the amount of money they spend as a foundation is huge. And they're able to set the agenda. They have to make a lot of difference, regardless of what the governments may or may not want. So there are a lot of opportunities that, you know, a country like Turkey can use and can hook up with. But I think it will be primarily, it has to be internal, I think. If you want to have a long-term impact, I think it has to be internal.
Shad, you traveled 3,000 miles to Boston. It's not exactly around the corner. But I'm really grateful that you did, and I'm sure the audience shares my view as well. What you provided us, not just in your lecture, but in your answers as well, is really a rich tapestry that is impressive, viewed as a whole, but a tapestry on which the components all bear inspection and development and so on. I mean, in a positive way, you really provoked us on a number of different issues. And in doing so, you've displayed great erudition and breadth, And I must say, I admire that.
Thank you very much.
And of course, your words will live on in video form. Our experience is that lectures such as yours will be viewed by thousands of people on the web. So who knows, you'll be receiving postcards and emails from who knows where.
I try not to read it.
Yeah, some of them you certainly don't want to read. Yeah. But Resat, thank you very much.
Thank you very much, yeah.
Bye-bye.
It's really a pleasure. Thank you.